Hello Seawolves and welcome to the show. Of course you're all big fans of the Vanden Globe and the Jules Verne, but there is of course another ocean race, and when I heard that one of the absolute beauties of that particular race, the ocean race, was actually parked only about an hour away from Amsterdam, of course I figured that we absolutely have to go over here and get a little bit of a technical tour. So I'm very happy to announce that we have Gideon Wellens with us today, and we're on board of VO65 Childhood, formerly named as a Brunel. So this boat actually came in third in the last edition, and I actually sailed with my little 38 footer quite close to this when they actually passed the finish. So it's really a cool feeling for me also to be on board here. Come with me, let's go inside and let's get a little bit technical with some of the cool features of this incredibly super cool Volvo 65. Let's get inside. Let's go in here. And we're joined here today by Gideon, the director of Sailing Holland. Thank you for allowing the Seawolves a little peek on board. And yeah, please show us all the beautiful intricacies of this wonderful Volvo 65.
Yes, yes. Happy to have you here. I mean, we are in the Volvo 65 Childhood. It's the old Team Brunel. I think everybody knows that one.
Yeah.
From the last edition of the Volvo Ocean Race. And now we have another sponsor, a foundation, and that's Childhood. We are here on the boat. We'll have a look. I mean, you see the big alternators here.
Yeah, what do we see here?
Charging the batteries, the lithium batteries, and the hydraulic pump for the keel cylinders. I mean, you can do that electric, and you can do that by starting the engine. You don't have a generator on the boat.
Yeah.
You only have to to run your engine, the main engine, to charge your batteries, making water with the water maker.
How long does it take to fill the batteries on this one fully?
Roughly about, lithium is going very quick. So a lot of capacity. It's about 1 hour a day for charging the batteries and making water. Depends of course how much you use the hydraulic ram, because that takes a lot. So if you
do you also actually have hydro generators on board last edition, or is that allowed within the Volvo?
Yeah, that's a good, that's you have to have them on board. I mean, you don't use them a lot because it's you take some drag in the water, but you have to have them on the boat, and but you don't use it.
Okay.
I mean, because with the lithium system is so efficient that you don't run the water hydro generator.
Nice.
But all the boats are, and that's the, I think that's the strong point from this kind of boats. I mean, it's full carbon. You can see it here. The whole construction is full carbon.
They're super strong.
With it, pretty bulletproof.
They don't
break. This is the, we're going now for the third time around the world, and we don't have any major construction problems. So I think it proved to be a good concept. The boats are all Eagle in weight, I mean, you're not allowed to drill a hole. Everything what you see, you're allowed to stick some things on, but you're not allowed to drill a hole, make the boat lighter. You have all the same sails, you have the same ropes. This is all, every boat have the same same materials.
Well, let's take a look. Shall we walk all the way up front and take a little bit of a look at all the cool systems? Yeah, so we're putting this back here.
I mean, here, this is there, the kitchen. I mean, you can see that here.
We're on the hearth, so we have some dryers inside. Look at that.
Pretty simple.
One pit burner.
Again, all the boats have the same, the weight is the same. I mean, and that makes it, the best sailors are win. And I think that's the good concept of a Volvo 65 campaign. I mean, you can see the hydraulic ramps. So of course,
They have two, So
On both sides.
Yeah.
I mean, it's so not titanium. It's normal nitronic.
In here, we can see it also.
So they are all connected to a bulkhead here.
That's also a redundancy that they have two, because many of the boats in the Mokas, for example, what we're following now, have one ram, but you have two. So that's also a redundancy, I guess.
Again, I mean, if you're sailing one design, of course, does it make that much difference to make a boat lighter, because everybody had the same problem with weight?
Yeah, I mean,
it's not a heavy boat, it's still full carbon, but on the critical components like a keel construction, they don't make any compromise.
Yeah.
So it's a little bit stronger, but it lasts also longer. It doesn't break.
Yeah. Okay, let's walk all the way to the front, and we'll make a front to the back technical little tour.
I mean, you can see we just crossed the main bulkhead. You can close that one.
Yeah.
If you hit something like a container or an iceberg, I mean, you can close all compartments.
Yeah. So we have on both sides here, for you guys can all see. Big carbon also bulkhead doors.
You have the same in the bow, so you have another one here. You can close that one, and there is a small one in the front. It's more a collision bulkhead.
Yeah, we see all the autographs of people.
We have a children program, so in every stopovers we have some school children on the boat.
Yeah, so two more bulkheads all the way up front there. And you can see, I guess, the furler unit there up front, or something like that. Nice.
This is a water ballast system. It's not for the stability, because it's in the middle. Mm-hmm. It's more for trimming the boat from the front to the aft. So for example, these boats are so fat on the back, you have a lot of drag.
Mm-hmm.
If you fill this this tank, you put all the sails forward, especially with light winds, you get the stern out,
and you
get less drag and it's faster. So that's the reason to. You have another two water ballast tanks in the back.
Yeah,
that's also, but they help also in the stability.
Yeah,
but this one is only for the longitudinal trim.
And I guess that this is also your sail locker, right? Because right now all the sails are not on board, of course.
Depends a little bit with light winds. Yes, because you want to trim the boat forward.
Mm-hmm,
but
mm-hmm.
Normally, all the sails are on deck for stability.
Yeah.
So every time you tack, then you have to move all the sails from one side to the other side. It's about 15 sails.
Yeah.
It's about 1.5 tons of weight if they dry, and most of the time they are wet, so it's a lot more.
Yeah.
But then you have to carry it from one side to the other side.
And I see that we also have the toilet in here.
Yeah, the carbon toilet.
The carbon throne. Nice. Yeah, so for those who want the romantic idea, can we get some light here? Look at that. Very nice. Very, very simple, I guess. Yeah, and we see some, safety lines hanging up here.
Yeah, this is more for ropes and to hold yourself if you're coming in. I mean, these boats are very aggressive in waves, to hold you is very important.
Yeah. And some more storage nets, I guess.
Yeah, on the back it's more for spare parts, food.
Yeah.
It's pretty close to the middle of the boat, so the center of the boat.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's very important for the pitching. So you get all the weights, just if possible, as close as possible to the keel.
Yeah. Cool. And what are all these big? Oh, that's the water inlets for the ballast, I guess. The big hoses here.
Now this is the system for the bilge pump system.
Ah, okay.
And the toilet you can empty.
What's this?
This is hydraulic ramps.
Ah, yeah.
That's for lines that are going up to the mast trim the mast. For example, the runners and the check stays. So we call it deflectors.
Uh-huh.
So you can pump from the back with the grinder. You can trim the mast with hydraulic cylinders.
Ah, okay.
There's a lot of high-tech things you don't see from the outside. You can see in the front also all the, when you work with halyard locks, that means the sails are all connected in the top of the mast, so there's no load on the halyards.
Mm-hmm.
And you all tension the sails on the bottom with hydraulic ramps. So you connect them in the top of the mast with a kind of clamp.
Yeah.
There's no tension on halyards.
Okay.
And then you tension them on the bottom.
Ah, wow, that's interesting.
To get the tight.
Oh, I had no idea. Ah, oh, that's so interesting. Okay, cool. Well, let's move a little bit more. So we're stepping here over the hydraulic ramps. We already talked about that and the engine. And this, of course, the sleeping arrangement here behind you.
Yeah,
to the side of me, of course.
The beds, so you sleep always on the high side or on the low side, depends from the wind, how much wind you have, help the stability.
Yeah.
Again, if you tack or jibe, you have to move all the weight food, sales, spare parts from one side to the other side.
We have one very important question. Thierry, can you take the camera for once? I have to tell, because I'm a pretty tall guy, right? So for all the tall people in the planet, is it okay if I climb in here
just to make a
little let's make a little test. So if a tall person like me can actually, well, I'm almost 2 meters tall, so this is still pretty doable. So nice. Pretty comfy actually. Yes! Thank you! Very cool! And is there anything else here in this particular, like I see some numbers for example there on the ceiling, can you tell a little bit, is there some cool things to be...
This is pretty simple.
About what's going in here?
This is for your toothbrush.
So
you
really?
Can put your toothbrush in.
Ah, okay.
So you have 9 people and you put it...
Nice.
You put them there.
Oh, that's cool.
Now this is more about emergency producers, procedures, tools. This is more sun cream.
This is like a modem or something over here? Looks like something to do
with... Yeah, that's all electronics.
Yeah.
I mean, you have here all the lines. Mm-hmm. Going to the center, so all the halyards.
Yeah. Oh, yeah,
going to the
cool
central cockpit wing. Yeah.
So here are a lot of cables. And also, there's also a B&G, I guess, a plotter up here?
Yeah, there's a small plotter.
That's if you want to poke your head in real quick and...
Normally you have remote portable screens.
Uh-huh.
But sometimes it's a backup system.
Yeah.
You don't use it a lot, but it's more... You have a lot of computers on this boat, about 5-6 computers.
Yeah.
I mean, normally the navigator is on the backside here. We go there to have a look.
Yeah.
I mean, they're working there with a computer.
Oh, shall we walk there actually? Then you can then you can show us. So here we go to the navigation station. With a nice chair also here. Very dark, by the way, guys, in here for...
you see the ventilator because it's pretty hot, especially in the tropics here. I mean, if you can imagine, you have 6 people cooking and sleeping down below, and it's very hot outside. It's pretty hot inside here, and so you can move the bunk, from one side to the other bunk.
So it's literally hanging by threads here.
Yeah,
and then hooked to
you
the.
You can adjust it here. You have 2 computers.
Yeah.
And a navigator on this kind of boats, or navigator is actually the wrong word. It's more a guy who's very busy with meteo, finding the right route.
Yeah.
Very busy with numbers, with performance, with...
He's polos. Basically doing what I do with the seawolves, but all day long keeping the show in the right direction.
Exactly. If he's sleeping, most of the time the skipper is taking over. So 80%, 70% of the time the navigator is taking care of it, and the other, of course, he has to sleep sometimes, and then the skipper is his backup.
Yeah, very nice. And for the people that it's just absolutely full of wires and technical stuff. Also here we can see up here, these are I guess also some of the lines of maybe of the... what are we seeing here, because we're also seeing some pumps and some different pipes going up here.
This is the winches.
That's the coffee grinders.
Going to there, and on the back side.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of wires with sensors. I mean, you can, for example, if you have too much pressure on the keel, then you get an alarm. So you have sensors on the rigging about when there's too much pressure. There's a lot of hydraulics. You have about 15 hydraulic cylinders beside the keel.
Yeah.
About trimming the mast and that kind of things. So there's a lot of hidden wiring and computers inside.
It looks simple.
But it's pretty complex.
Yeah, and there are also some bunks here, huh? So there's actually right here, because you have of course 9 people on board, I guess, during the race, right?
Yes.
So we have here 4 more bunks that are kind of right behind, and then if we continue climbing on, I guess we're gonna get to the steering. Oh, something fell. I don't know what that was. Probably my phone.
Yeah, this is more the onboard reporter. So you have a guy on the boat who's taking care of all the media.
Oh yeah, my microphone.
I mean, it's compulsory in the race to have an onboard reporter who's not allowed to sail. So he has to deliver every day an amount of media content, written, pictures, stories. And if he don't produce that, because
No,
because it's actually the guy is in charge from the organization. So he's not belonging to the crew. So they switch. So it must be not a sailor, it must be a really media guy.
Okay.
So it's a benefit for the sponsors, it's a benefit for the race. And that's very important in ocean race to
is
have.
Is that also interesting relationship for the team, I guess, to have somebody, is that reporter with them also before the race, already kind of part of the team, or is it very much like last minute, you just get one assigned and they say, well, this is the guy that's going to go with you around? And
so the first time you were allowed to choose, so that's now 6-7 years ago.
Okay, yeah.
You were allowed to choose your own onboard reporter. Mm-hmm. And then you get reading the stories from the people, from the crew and internal stories. The last time, they changed about every two legs, you get another onboard reporter. We were not so happy with it because you don't get really part of the team. It will be a guy really external. I prefer the first to have your own onboard reporter, of course.
Teach
by the ocean race. Yes, I can recommend. I can understand that. But trust from the crew, and then you get the real stories.
Yeah.
So I prefer the first option.
Nice. And there's also these are like satellite phones or something?
You have your satellite phones, so you're possible to, of course, internet. Everything is controlled by the headquarters in Alicante. Uh-huh. So if you send an email to
more winches, I guess, also what we see here.
Yeah, that's also grinders. So, but all media content and all messages from the boat is first going to the organization, and then it's going to your family.
Yeah.
Every week you can send a small message. I mean, you're not allowed to have external info about tactical decisions.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not allowed. You have to make your decisions on the boat.
Yeah, but it makes sense, right? Yeah. To make sure that nobody gets.
Otherwise, you have 5-6 people flying with a helicopter above. Where's the wind? Yeah.
And you never tried it in code language, like the chocolate is real hot over there in Argentina. You better have some cold ice cream over in
I don't think that's going to happen. Of course, it's possible, but I don't think that's going to happen.
The saving is a gentleman's sport, right? Well, what's underneath here? Because I'm kind of curious.
It's all storage. It's nothing in. It's really safety things, and it's all storage.
Okay. On the backside. Because now I have to. By the way, we're really all crawling around here. Huh? So for the people who are watching this, like, this is a pretty narrow, low space, and this is the steering quadrant, I guess.
It's another watertight bulkhead. So you can also close this one. For example, if you break a rudder and the rudder stock is breaking out of the hull, then you have a big hole in the back, and then you can close this one.
Yeah.
But here you can see really the connection of the two rudders with the big arms, the black ones, with the car connected to the not wires, but Spectra ropes, and that's going through the wheels outside.
Wow, so cool.
I mean, for example, when the boat is upside down, then you have an escape hatch in the back.
Yeah,
so you can climb out there. That's the only possibility if the boat upside down, is that you can still go out there.
Wow, that must be so. If you're actually sailing and you have to crawl in here to fix something while underway, that must be really tough.
Yeah,
we see some bilge pumps and different things, of course, going around here. Where is the water ballast then?
The ballast bag is on the back here. You can see the water ballast.
Oh, okay.
It's on this side.
Oh, that's the little thing. Oh, yeah, okay.
You can see here, the hull is going like that. It's not very big. It's about.
And it's also on this side, then?
Yes.
Yes. Where is it then here?
Yeah, it's behind the white plate.
I mean, behind there. Okay, yeah. So it's behind this is the water ballast. Okay.
It's a part of the construction. It's a part of the hull.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You can see that. Oh, yeah. Some ventilators also in here. Very nice. Very cool.
Okay. Een beetje zo met de rug naar de wind, dat is best voor de mic, denk ik. Yeah, so we're outside. Is there some other cool things that you can
show us? We have two entry hatches.
Yeah.
Coffee grinder here.
The coffee grinder. This is the winch for the halyards. I mean, you can see the jammers. You can see here all the lines.
Is it constrictor jammers or?
It's all spin lock.
Oh, okay.
And I mean, these lines are the trip lines. What I said about the halyards.
Uh-huh.
So you connect the halyards in the top of the mast and you tension them in the bottom.
Yeah.
And this is the release system of the halyard lock in the top of the mast.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that's going also inside. Mm-hmm. I mean, on this side it's more the dagger boards. You have two dagger boards on the side. They are off now. You can see the big holes in the deck.
Yeah.
That's the idea.
Yeah, so we have a bunch of winches, of course, here, the control and of course the steering. And what kind of because I see most of the plotters and all this type of stuff in here, that's not located near the steering wheel at all. You have to like walk up to see that, or you can actually
You have about there. 5 clocks, big ones on the mast.
Of course,
under the boom. They are right there. This is more for navigation and for the trimmers.
Yeah.
And on the back side you have one here. And you still have two instruments here.
Oh yeah. Oh, that's cleverly hidden there. Yeah.
So this one you can
set up pretty steeply if you need it. Yeah.
You have a lot of heel.
Yeah.
You can stand straight. You can stand very stable.
Yeah.
You can hook yourself on here. You have the lines, the live lines.
Yeah.
You have the traveler, all the hydraulics.
Oh yeah. Nice.
All the hydraulics buttons. It's a pretty fancy and system. And on the cup, on the America's Cup, you can see also the guys are all grinding.
Yeah.
And that's producing hydraulic tension. Mm-hmm. That's the same on this system.
Yeah, and then you can release it when you need it.
Exactly.
Huh? Yeah.
So you building up power with hydraulics with the grinder.
Yeah.
And then you can work on the buttons.
Nice.
This is an intercom, so you can speak. You can speak with the navigator. For example, if you are close to shore, rocks, reefs.
Yeah.
Then you have a communication with the navigator, because down below you have a lot more. It's no waves and no wind, so he can concentrate a lot more on the computer screen than outside here with the screen and waves and a lot of people hanging around.
Yeah.
So that's the reason the intercom is there.
Ah, okay, cool. So of course we missed the toast there, but now we have a toast here. So for all of you that were still waiting with your coffee, here we go. 3, 2, 1. Oh. Ooh, that's extra good since we just came from outside and we're pretty cold right now. But we're warming up in Gideon's office. And so can you tell us a little bit more about the program now? Because obviously, you know, we're all following the Vendée Globe, but soon, you know, the circus of the ocean race is also hopefully going to start again as the corona thing hopefully goes away over the next year or so. So what are you guys doing now? Obviously the boat is on the heart for a little bit, and what does the rest of the year look like for Childhood?
Yeah, the boat is now for 5 months on shore.
Mm-hmm.
So from November till March, half of March, the boat's going into the water.
Mm-hmm.
Then we do some maintenance, practice, test sailing, crew test sailing, and then after that, around half of April, third week of April, the boat's going to Poland, because the ocean race is postponed for 1 year.
Mm-hmm. And so it's 2022 now, right?
Yes, October 2022.
Okay.
And
put it in the agenda, everybody. October 2022.
Yeah.
We have a new race again. Yeah.
And this year is a little bit a year which we were pushing very hard to the organization to have something together with all the boats, because it's still very good that the One Design is still alive and all the boats are sold to new owners.
Yeah.
And so we have a strong class now.
Mm-hmm.
We have a class association that's pretty new.
Mm-hmm.
So all the 65 owners are talking with each other.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that makes it the class president is Ken Reed. That's the managing director of Norsails.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
So it makes really sense to speak with one voice to the ocean organization.
Mm-hmm.
And also for them, it's a lot easier. And we decided to go for a race this year, all the boats together from Poland, to Lithuania, Denmark, Den Haag. We stay for 1 week in Den Haag. Nice. And then we have the race from Lorient to Cascais, from Cascais to Saint-Tropez, from Saint-Tropez to Genoa, and finishes in June.
Yeah, and that's called the Round World, or what?
The Round Europe race.
Oh, the Round Europe race, yeah.
And I think that's very good. I mean, it will be race, yes, but it also will be a high level of guest sailing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's a combination.
Yeah.
So it will be young people, because it's compulsory now in the ocean race to have a combination of experienced people and younger and a mixed crew.
Mm-hmm.
So all these aspects together, I mean, it's a good training this summer, and in combination with sponsors.
Mm-hmm.
So some sponsors will be on the boat, an onboard reporter will be on the boat. So it's a very good test case to do this.
Yeah.
And so we're looking forward. I mean, hopefully Corona is gone in that period. And after that, the boat is going back to the northern part of Europe. So that will be in July, August. We do some corporate sailing for our sponsors.
Mm-hmm.
And then in August, we have the Fastnet this year. So yeah, very nice program.
Yeah, very nice.
Very nice program.
Yeah.
We have some obligations with childhood, because it's
that may be good to say also, because that's a foundation. So that's your new main sponsor, and they are fighting against, I guess, violence against children, or child abuse, let's say, right?
Yeah, it's not a sponsor. It's really, we're sailing under the name Childhood.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So they don't put any money in it.
Ah, okay.
So it's a foundation, mm-hmm, against protection for children worldwide,
mm-hmm,
about house violence, about sexual abuse, mm-hmm, about internet, etc., etc.
Yeah.
So I think it's a very good case, and we're very proud to sailing for Childhood.
Nice.
So they're not the main sponsor, but they back us, and people.
Is that featuring also in your program in a way that the Sea Wolves later can participate in or donate to, or how does it work?
Yeah, I mean the companies behind Childhood, who, mm-hmm, funding Childhood, they are connected to us also, and they sponsor us.
Uh-huh.
And the Childhood Foundation is started by the Queen of Sweden,
mm-hmm,
Queen Sofia, and she's the founder of the foundation. So we have a strong connection. I mean, the boat is Dutch. It's a Dutch registered boat.
Yeah.
And Sailing Holland is Dutch, but we have a very strong connection to Sweden.
Cool.
We have a lot of sponsors also in Sweden, so it's a combination.
Nice.
Which is working very well.
Yeah.
The last 2 years we did a lot of racing in Scandinavia. We did a round Gotland race,
mm-hmm,
and we were about 3 months ago, we were in Stockholm.
I saw it, yeah.
A lot of, and we did a round Denmark race. Of course, our skipper Bauer Becking is Danish. So we have a lot of connection to Scandinavia.
That's nice. So I actually talked to Anita when you did the delivery to Denmark or something. I was almost had time to go on. But unfortunately missed it, but maybe as well.
For sure we're going to find an opportunity this summer.
How, to get back to the more technical part, because so now she's on the hard, how does the maintenance work? Because it's a very strictly maintained one class. You're doing some things yourself, but there's also, I think before the ocean race itself, there's one moment when all the boats go through the same process to like completely ensure that everything is the same weight-wise, everything gets compensated. Can you tell us a little bit about how that works?
Yeah, I mean the rule is very strict. It's really very strict.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're going to weigh the boat, they're going to weigh the keel, they're going to NDT the hull and the keel.
Mm-hmm.
And that means NDT means scan.
Yeah.
If there is any delamination in the carbon.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So you're not allowed to change ropes. If you change them, it has to be by this manufacturer. So it's very, the diameters are all, it's very close. So
nice.
Again, the best sailors are going to win this race.
Yeah,
it's not about the money.
I mean,
So that works very well. And the boat will be checked next winter. So now it's a little bit free. I mean, you're not allowed to drill any holes, and to change things. Mm-hmm. Also for the round Europe days, I mean, it's really the boat has to be in one design. Mm-hmm. And next winter there will be a refit, and they're going to check that. Also the whole hydraulic systems. If you, for example, if you want to cheat, and you can keel, you can change the angle of your keel about 2 degrees more.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a big advantage.
Okay. Yeah.
So all these things will be checked. I don't say that I want to cheat, but I mean, it's good that the rules are.
I think it's very cool. It's also really known as a very, very strict one class.
Yeah.
And I think that really makes it also just like what we see in the Vendée now, that many of the boats are so close together. It really, I think, adds to also the audience enjoyment of seeing the race where not everybody is, you know, 1,000 miles from each other, but they're all, you know, within 100, 200, 300 miles from each other. That makes it so much more exciting. And that was definitely also very cool in the previous, when it was still the Volvo, to see it as such a close race. And of course, Bauwe also really coming back. And of course, I was actually sailing here when they came into the finish, and we were all like, yeah, Bauwe's gonna win this thing, still coming back.
Yeah, I don't want to talk really exciting. I don't want to talk about that the last 12 hours.
That was one little technical,
I was at 6 o'clock in the morning, I was on the water in the rip. And we were, at that stage, we were still first. And we lost. So it was not our.
That was not our day. But it was a very, I have to say, amazing day. So many boats came out, and it was such a spectacle. It was really. We managed to get into one of the helicopter shots when you see the winner come in. We're like the one sailing boat going in the wrong direction, like right beside them. It was really cool. It was super fun. Okay, and is there also because there is also a program with you guys doing trainings, right? When the boat goes back in the water again, and this is kind of good for the Seawolves to know. So we don't know exactly the dates yet. But me and Gideon already talked about it, and so we're going to make something happen, of course, depending on how everything goes with Corona, what we can do. But maybe somewhere in April or end of March, when the boat is here, we can do like a training day with you guys, with some Seawolves, if you're interested. We'll make a price for that, and we'll put something on the website. So keep an eye out for that, and we're going to make some kind of training day or something happen when we can do some actual sailing with some cool guys on board of Childhood. I think that would be really fun.
For sure.
Okay, well, I'm going to actually hop over back to the boat, because we're going to hop in the navigation chair, and that's where we're going to do all the rest of the day today, about actually everything going on in the Vendée Globe and the Jules Verne. But Gideon, thank you very much for showing us around, and I'm sure we'll be back here again at some point. So we'll hop over now.
Pleasure.
So we made it back into the Childhood. I'm actually in the where normally the navigator is sitting, and this is actually quite comfortable here with my laptop, so that definitely works even for a very big person like me, so that's very nice to feel. But of course, unfortunately, while we were doing the show here today, the news also reached me about Pip Hare and the fact that she actually damaged her rudder.
It's not good news on Medallia today. This afternoon, see here, got my sails down and I'm waddling along because about 2 hours ago, just in a routine check of the boat, I discovered that the port rudder stock was cracked, and I'm not far off losing the rudder from the port side. Luckily, I was sailing on port, so that wasn't the rudder under load. And I have disconnected it completely, so it's no longer under load. And I'm sailing on port very, very gently. I've got a spare rudder. And I've been working with Joff to make a plan on how and when I can fit that. The deciding factor on that is going to be sea state. You can see I've still got quite a lot of residual swell behind me from the big breeze last night, and then I don't know if you can see these clouds here, so that's another 30 knotter that's coming through tonight. I'm so gutted because it's actually 30 knots slightly from the south, so I was going to jibe onto starboard and ride that along the AEZ. Not anymore. So my job now, racing is suspended. My job now is to keep Medallia in best shape possible, wait it out until I got the suitable conditions to put this rudder in. And it's all about just staying safe and stable. And then when the rudder's back in again, I can race again. I'm devastated. But these things happen. It happens. And I can't change that. All I can do is find a solution, sort it out, and then start racing again when I'm ready and come back at it again. And I've had these things happen to me before, and there's always something to come back for, and there's always something to come back at. So, you know, I'm very accepting of what's happened, and I'm very confident that we will find a solution. The main thing is, I'm not at risk, Medallia's not at risk. We've got everything in place to solve this problem and then to carry on racing. At the moment, that'll be either we might have a window to put the rudder in tomorrow. If the sea state isn't suitable, then on the 9th, so in 2 days' time, there's going to be a big high pressure over this whole area, so no wind, and I may well just have to wait for 2 days and do it then. But we'll do it at the best time for ultimate success, and when it's done, I'll be back in the game.
So I just had a little talk with their director, and the latest on it is that so during routine checking, she found that she had a crack in one of the rudders, and fortunately she does have a spare rudder on board, and she also has trained. I saw her actually do this before, in being able to replace this rudder herself. So it's not over. She's suspended racing for now, so that's really unfortunate. But you know, she made it to 15th place in the race. That's a huge achievement. Now the main thing is that she's going to have to wait for the weather to clear up a little bit, so that the situation gets a bit more flatter, so that she's hopefully able to replace the rudder, and then in theory the boat would be, you know, back to as good as new, let's say, and she'd be able to fully resume racing. But we have to hope that she's able to do it. So let's dive into the screen right here real quick. And I already looked her position up here, and so we can see that she's still a little bit in the strong weather right now. But as we talked about yesterday, this kind of more lighter area is going to be moving east, and so in about she's obviously not going to be moving forward, but so in a few hours that weather should actually that's not moving right now. Yeah, so the internet's a little bit slow here on the boat, but as you can see, a few hours from now that should move up there, meaning that she will get much more acceptable wind speeds, actually a little area there, 6, 7, maybe 8 knots. So that should definitely calm the seas down a little bit, and she will probably have about 20 hours or so, if I look at the predictions right now, for her to actually affect repair. So it's about 7 or 8 hours from now until that weather, you know, catches up with her, and then about 20 to maybe 25 hours when she is in a clear zone before this weather that's kind of behind her, which will be again 25 to 30 knots, is going to end up catching up with her again and putting her again in conditions where it will be very hard to sail. So a lot of pressure on Pip. On the other hand, if she's able to make this repair within 20 hours, then she might be able to more or less keep a pretty good position, because she's definitely going to fall back, I guess, at least 3 places. But with any luck, she might be able to actually make this repair before Di Da Costa and of course, who else is behind her, before Stéphane Le Dérigeant catches up with her. So on the other hand, of course, the most important thing now is to fix the boat and you know, get back home safely. She is still in the big bad Southern Ocean, but I for my mind hope that she's also able to do it fairly quickly, and so she actually won't lose too much position and still be, you know, fully in the race at that point. And you know, until that moment, we just have to wait and see. But I'll keep you updated, of course, on that. So now that we have that on the way, a little sidestep to Gitana 17, the Edmund de Rothschild and the Jules Verne. They are still on part to depart tomorrow. I don't know an exact time yet, but we'll definitely have a special segment in the show tomorrow talking about that. And the good news, I guess, is that we might have a departure tomorrow or Saturday for Gitana 17. So that's very, very cool to see. Then let's move up to the front, because we definitely also see some interesting developments happening there. Let me get to the moment right now. And the main thing that we see is that the distance that Yannick Besthaven has gained over the last 20 hours or so is really massive. He went from a 320 or so nautical mile lead to 428 miles now. So another 100 miles added to his lead, and we see him again in quite favorable winds now, while we see both Charlie and Thomas both fully beating. So they're in speeds that are, you know, 13, 14 knots or so, while Yannick is doing a very nice 17.6 right now, and over the last 24 hours, 15.6. So I have to say, as far as navigation talent and just very good strategy, Yannick has absolutely aced it over the last 24 hours. So that is really, really super cool to see. And of course, when we look at the rest of the field, we see that they're not in a very favorable position, the hunters, as we've come to call them. So we see that they're all moving more or less northeast right now, moving closer to the system, hoping to make attack, but not quite in the right position for that yet. And so they are also losing a lot of miles, especially towards Yannick, with actually Damien Sagan now in the lead, almost 500 miles behind the leader, 440 right now. So massive, massive gap there. And then behind them, we see another big gap with Isabel Joschke, or sorry, Clarice Kramer, and Armel Trippel now very, very close together. Let me see what the actual distance here is, because it's kind of interesting to see. Yeah, so they are, he's a thousand, so they are 30 miles apart from each other. Yesterday it was still a little over 100, but look at how close they are together. And yeah, right now Clarice in a bit of a lull, right there off the Falkland Islands. So she's doing 8.6, with Armel doing 10.8 still over the last 24 hours, but also quickly slowing down. So they have a bit of a high pressure zone right in front of them. And I think that by the end of the day, they're gonna be pretty much in the same location, stuck in the same high pressure together before they can race past the Falklands. So that's going to be a duel over the last few days to see which one of those two is going to win out on that, but gonna be very cool to follow. We see Roman Attanasio very close to the coast here, also just passing the Cape, so he made it through safely, which is nice to see. And then we have a whole big lot of nothing before we see Pip here. So currently still a little bit ahead of Alan Rora, and Arnaud Bozeris, but they're not far off again. And Pip obviously right now almost not making any speed. And behind there, coming up very quickly, also Jeremy Bijou. And so he's also, of course, going to be passing Pip, I think, in the next 24 hours or so. He's already in the slightly lighter winds, though. But you can see, especially in this picture really good, how close the lighter winds are to Pip. So it's literally, like I said, 3 hours maybe. And then you have to allow for another 2-3 hours for the seas to, you know, calm down a little bit, because that does happen pretty quickly when the wind goes down. But it still takes some time for her to get to a sea state where she'll be able to really start affecting repairs and actually take the rudder out, because that's a very tough maneuver, especially to do that on your own with a fast or with a heavy rudder, and you know, all the rigging that she has to do to get the lines ready to hold it on and essentially drop it from under the boat, take it on board, or maybe just let it go and then put the new rudder there. It's going to take her some actually diving, maybe swimming under the boat. It's a very, very tough operation. And tomorrow we had scheduled an interview with her technical director, so I hope that's still going to happen. But on the other hand, I can't fault him if he's, you know, busy tomorrow guiding Pip through this whole maneuver. But we'll see if we can still get the interview tomorrow. We're going to be talking about all those details about what Pip actually has to do to drop the rudder, get the new one in. So that'll be very interesting. And for the rest of the field, we see everything pretty much in a good position right now, so not much to say there. Basically all the way up to Sebastian Destremeux, everybody sailing nicely, no real crazy weather challenges there. So that's pretty much it for the overview right now. And this episode is already going very, very long with everything that happened, so that's where I'm going to cut it for today.
Oh, so thank you all again for watching. Make sure to give the video a thumbs up if you want to see, you know, nice more episodes on location like this. And of course, make sure to subscribe and hit that bell icon. For all the other information, go to seawolvestv.com, and we'll see you again with a cup of coffee tomorrow.